Yeah, here, for having an interaction between two people who lived through Agra Gharana, gave their life to Agra Gharana, thought about Agra Gharana all these years. What we would like to listen from you is the two aspects. One, all these years, your life in Agra Gharana, and the other aspect is the Agra Gharana as such, the contribution of Agra Gharana to Indian music tradition as such, the influences of Agra Gharana to other gharanas, then the significance of Agra Gharana, then the specific characteristics.
No, I was born and brought up in Bangalore, and my parents must have realized that I was interested in music from a very young age, because I believe by the age of, before the age of three, they used to put recorded 3 minute, those records, yes, on the, before I went to sleep, and I could recognize which was who was singing which rag or whatever. So they were very keen that I should pursue music. So at the age of about 11, they asked Pandit Ram Rao Naik, who was a very renowned teacher in Bangalore, to come and teach me at home. And I think from then on, my life has been with Agra Gharana. Before that, when I was about 3 years old, I believe my parents took me to listen to an all-night concert of Ustad Fayaz Khan Sahab. And I believe I sat through the whole concert without making a noise. So I guess maybe that is when I believe the die was cast, you know, that for me, that Agra Gharana was to be my future musical
journey.
Yes, anyway. So, and he belonged to the Agra Gharana. Now, in those days in Bangalore, you didn't have a choice, much of a choice, as to whom to learn from or what to learn from. Nor did my parents aware of all these various, diversities that exist. And he was a good teacher, so that was how it was, as if the die was cast. You know, there was no choice, and he came into our lives, and. That was how I started learning. And he belonged to a very traditional school of thought. Those days they were very traditional, both in their family life, in their daily life, and in their approach to the music, because they had learned from Gharanedar musicians. So, but he was a very forward thinking in the way he taught. I think Bharti will agree to that.
Yes, me too.
He was not rigid in the way he taught, which you would expect from a teacher of that generation. He was very open, and he had a knack of bringing out the best in his students. If he found somebody good at picking up various rags, he would not stick to one rag. If he found somebody good at bandishes, he would start, you know, he made things interesting, and he didn't make it a drudgery or sort of something that you would be sort of start wondering, oh, is he coming, is my teacher coming home this evening? Because, you know, unlike their generation, we were all people who went to school, who had other activities. Music was not our sole, and I think for all our generation, our parents taught us music not as a profession, but as a something to be learned, something to be enjoyed. And later, maybe if we, if we were good at it, then we could take it up as a, but it was never meant to be a profession. It was meant to be mainly a pastime, at least in my case. So, it was not as if we had to practice so many hours. You know, he could not lay down those rules for us because the conditions at home were totally different. And he realized that, which I think was a very good plus point in his favor, because that was how he kept the interest of the students and all of us. And he was able to train so many of us. Many of us were on the performing stage: M.R. Gautam, Lalita Ubhaykar, Lalita Ramanujam, Meera Sawoor, myself, Bharati, Shanta Jaitirtha. There were some people who belonged, who learned, Suman.
Sumaji.
Suman Nagarkatte. So many youngsters he trained into performing musicians. Whether they reached the All India stage or not doesn't matter, because that depended on their, not necessarily their capability, but they had other things to do. Many were housewives, many didn't. But he had a remarkable talent for bringing out the best in his students and for raising them in the traditional style. Mm. So that was how I started learning. And performing. Now performing comes not necessarily because of someone's effort or partly due to effort, but also because of the talent one is being blessed with. Some people may learn, they may be very interested, they may be very dedicated, but they do not have that musical quality about them which makes them a performer.
The role of creativity.
Creativity may be there, but there are so many things that go into all this. So maybe God had blessed me with that. All the my circumstances, my parents were supportive. So I did start performing after 3 years of learning from him. I gave my first concert for Bangalore Sangeet Sabha and things like that. But when I grew up, music was never the topmost in my priority or in my parents' priority. It was always studies. And they didn't want me to do only one thing. So I was encouraged to play games, I was encouraged to, you know, various activities. So this continued, and then at that time, my knowledge of Agra Gharana was very basic. I knew I belonged to the Agra Gharana. And when some Agra Gharana musician came here, like Sharafat Hussain Khan or somebody, then my guru would say, go and listen to them. But those were days when recordings were not available. Tape recorders were very rare. So it was mainly music through the radio. And that was also restricted because in Karnataka, North Indian music was very
limited.
So maybe your exposure to Gharanedar music was on national program. So I remember listening to national program of Vilayat Hussain Khan, Sharafat Hussain
Khan. Saturdays.
Yes, Saturdays. I think most of us grew up that way. Then I went into my education. And music went into the background for quite a few years. It was only in 1967 when I got married and we moved to Delhi that music, which had taken such a back seat, re-entered my life. And I started learning from Dinkar Kaikini, Pandit Dinkar Kaikini, who was then stationed in Delhi, and he was also part of the general Agra framework. Maybe you would ask why I didn't go to Yunus Hussain Khan Sahib, who was there. But as I said, my knowledge of the gharana was very little. And we knew Dinkarji because we had heard him singing right from my childhood. He used to come to Bangalore very often. And so it was maybe very natural that we went to him. And it was a continuation of the same, you know, thought processes, the school, the way of learning, everything. Then, and it was mainly a sort of brushing up, brushing off all the cobwebs, getting back into that musical frame of mind. And he was a brilliant performer and a very good, brilliant teacher. But before we could progress on that journey, we were transferred to Bombay. And that is when, for me at least, Agra Gharana became my my entry into the Gharana. Really started from there. Okay, why did I go to Khadim Hussain Khamsa? Or you can ask, how did you hear of Khadim Hussain? Because as I told you, I didn't know much about the Gharana.
Oh, before getting into Khadim Hussain Khan, tell me, who were the other Agra musicians with whom you were familiar with?
You see, when I grew up in Bangalore, as I told you, on the radio you come to hear of Vilayat Hussain, Khadim Hussain, Latafat Hussain, Sharafat Hussain. But there are so many musicians in the country, and if you remember, 1 week used to be North Indian music, 1 week used to be South Indian music. And there are so many musicians. So the chance of hearing, say, even Vilayat Hussain or Khadim Hussain or anybody, more than once or twice, is
in a year.
Not even in a year.
Yes.
See, it's only 54 weeks, so 27, so 27 artists per year. And out of that, Kirana, this, that, so many. So maybe once in 3-4 years or 4-5 years, you would get the artist get a chance again. So you, my exposure was mainly to Dinkarji, who used to come here, and Chidanand Nagarkar, who belonged to Bangalore, who belonged to the same Agra branch of Radhanyankar. They were all Radhanyankar students. And also because our community was the major one which supported North Indian music. Maybe that is how these people came here. Then Gindeji used to come, S.A.R. Bhatt used to come. Khansabs was mainly through what Ram Rao said, or through few recordings, which were hardly negligible. And so then, why did I choose Khadim Hussain Khamsa? You know, when I was young and studying here, once we had gone to Bombay, and my mother's cousin was Saguna Kalyan, and used to learn from Khadim Hussain Khamsa. And once when we went there, she said, will you sing in my house? I was about 13, 14. So, said, fine. And, you know, now as a child, as a 13-year-old or a 14-year-old, you have no problem. Someone asks you to sing, you sing. You don't realize, oh, is this gharana, is that, am I singing right? And it was a fun thing for me. We were just singing. So when I sang there, before that, her uncle used to come and stay with us. And he always used to tell me, oh, you must hear Khadim Hussain Khamsa. You must listen to Khadim Hussain Khamsa. And he teaches Saguna Kalyan Pura. You know, so that was my only link to Khamsa. But I never thought of it because we were in Bangalore. He was in Bombay. And there was no chance of my being sent there. So the question didn't arise. So I went to sing here, and once when I started, there were a few friends. Then there was a knock on the door, and somebody walked in. Not very tall, very slim, thin, dark, with a dhoti and a kurta and a waistcoat. Now, I didn't even notice or doesn't seem to have entered my head that he could be a musician. He came and he sat down and I sang. I don't even remember whether Sagunaji, you know, told me that this is Khansa. And you see, we were not aware of the, at that time, how you would react when an Ustad comes. How you react when a senior musician comes. You know, we were not sort of schooled or we were not exposed to the niceties or the that way of life. Living in a place like Bangalore. So after I sang, Sagunaji came and told me this is Khatim Hussain Khansa. Now that rang a bell. So I did touch his feet and then he came and said, no, you, I'm glad I came because you sang well and Ram Rao belongs to my same gharana. So I'm very happy. I'll give you my blessings. And then he left. You know, just a sentence and fine. I continued. We were sitting around having lunch with them. And then there was a knock on the door again. So he walked in again. So he came in and he said, do you mind if I tell you something? So I said, no, not at all. So he said to me, because you belong to my gharana, you are like my own disciple. And the desi that you sang was very nice, except for one small portion. I don't think your teacher would have taught you that way. This is because he is like a brother to me, belonging to the gharana. I'm sure he didn't teach you like that, because that doesn't fit in with the form of desi. Go back and ask him, and if he says no, what you did is not right, correct it. Because you are the future of, all of you are the future of the gharana. And we have to see and then he went. And I was really struck by that gesture of his, because for all, for common, I mean, in the day, in scheme of things, he would never have seen me again. I would never have seen me again because I was not a professional musician, nor was I planning to be. And this was some chance, you know, meeting. He heard me and he thought of all this. He came, he took that interest. You know, it showed the dedication of that man to the gharana, to the music, to the youngsters, who had literally no connection with him except that in the general frame of things they belonged to the gharana. And I was totally impressed by that. And I decided that if ever I get to Bombay, I'm going to learn from him. So then when we moved from Delhi to Bombay, this is, I was sure whom I wanted to learn from. Many people told me, why do you want to learn from Agra Gharana? It's a very difficult gharana. It's a male-oriented gharana. And there are so many other musicians here. He belongs to the old school. His teaching methods are old. There are so many younger musicians who have learned a lot, who are musicologists. Why don't you? But I didn't have any confusion in my mind. My mind was made up and that was what I was going to do. So, and it was so sweet, you know, we rang up Saguna Kalyanpur and said, now we've come to Bombay. Please tell us where he is, because I would like to go and ask him if he'll come and teach me. So, she said, fine, I'll let him know. I'll call you back. So after a few days, we were living in Malabar Hill in my father-in-law's house. So there was a knock on the door. Knocks on the door seem to be very important in my life. So we opened the door and there stood Khansa. I was literally stunned. So we called him in and we said, he says, my Khadim Hussain, he opened the door.
My Khadim Hussain, the moment I heard the name Khadim Hussain,
he came and sat and he said, Saguna ne mujhe phone kiya ki tum mere paas seekhna chahti ho aur mujhe yaad hai maine tumhe suna tha jab tum choti thi aur main yahi sikhane aata hu to maine socha dekh ke jaunga. Look at the humility of that
the great
ustad, not even being invited, not even being asked to come, just I guess that we were made to be there are some connections that are destined. And I believe so. That was how he started teaching. Yeah. And he did a small he said, so we said, now what are we, he said, nahi ganda bandhna hi padega, bagair ganda bandhan hum nahi sikhate. No, what ganda bandhan was, I didn't know anything. So but we were determined that, so we said, okay, we'll whatever. She said, usme koi baat nahi hai, usme yehi hai ki ganda bandhan jo hota hai, then officially I accept you as my student. I didn't realize the significance of what ganda bandhan meant. It was not a restricting term, as we people think now, or some people think now, that if you are a ganda bandhan shagird of somebody, then you cannot learn from anyone. Nobody, it is restricting you or limiting you to learning only from him, and nobody else can. It was not that. This is a very interesting, thought process behind it. In the gharanas, what used to happen? There were lots of musicians. Some used to teach, some used to perform. Now what happens? There is no internet those days. There is no TV, only radio. So what happens? People who are famous get known. So everybody wants to learn from them. Everybody wants to learn from Fayaz Khan Sahib. Everybody wants to learn from Sharafat Hussain. Everybody wants to learn from Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Sahib. Now, so they accept you as a student. Then what happens? They are performing. So what happens to your lessons? So any other ustad from the gharana, if you go to them and say, please teach me, they have to say yes, because you are part of the gharana and you are ganda bandhan shagird of somebody from them. It was like a brotherhood, that you had a right, you were free to go and ask anybody from the gharana. That so when, and this must have happened very often, say with Fayaz Khan Sahib and Atta Hussain Khan Sahib in Bombay, in Baroda, because Fayaz Khan Sahib had a lot of students, but he was performing all the time. So Atta Hussain Khan Sahib was the teacher of many of the Agra.
Most of those who claimed to be Fayaz Khan's students
were really taught
by Atta Hussain.
And the extent of Fayaz Khan Sahib's teaching was, when he performed in the evenings, they would sit behind him or sit in front. And when he performed, they imbibed what they could.
It must be applicable to all these major musicians who are touring a lot.
Could be. I know that this is the thing in our Agra school. So, ganda bandhan, it has a very beautiful thought behind it. And if Atta Hussain used to teach so many people, because he was mainly stationed there as a teacher. And in, it was like a complimentary thing. When the person to whom you were had a ganda bandhan ceremony, he was there, you learned from him. When he went, your teaching was not disturbed, because it was somebody else from the family or from the gharana to take over that teaching process.
Classic example is Saguna Kalyanpur. She used to learn from Anwar Hussain Khan, who is the younger brother of Khadim Hussain Khan. Anwar Hussain passed away very young. So immediately Khadim Hussain Khan took over.
And
that was the
yes.
tradition in the Ghara.
And Vilayati Sen Khan Sahib used to teach some people in Bombay. And then when he moved to Delhi, automatically Khadim Hussain Khan Sahib went and, you know, I believe Vilayat Hussain Khan Sahib would tell his student, "Koi baat nahi, main ja raha hoon, magar mera bhanja hai, wo aake sikhaye." You know, so it was a sort of they never let the student down. At least I like to think of it that way, because it was not a restricted thing. It was where you thought of the student in more ways than one. So that was how my life with Khan Sahib started. And I was very lucky in one thing. Both Khan Sahib's and Ram Rao's approaches to music were the same. They never laid down any rules. But you have to sing this way, you have to sing the bandish, the rag, yes. But afterwards, the elaboration, as long as you stuck to within the rag, your taal was all right, they would allow you to imagine and create. And then if they found something lacking, they would correct you. So they never stifled your creativity.
In your concept, or in Agra Gharana, as such, you know, what is imagination?
Imagination, okay. You have the basic framework of the rag. Suppose you take a certain phrase. In how many ways can you develop that phrase? See, all Indian music, we have the basic framework of the raga. And then, whether it's North Indian or South Indian, you sing the bandish or the composition, and then you develop that. That portion is the creativity, isn't it? Because the bandish is set, and the rag is set, in the sense the framework is there. So how you develop, that is the creativity, that is the basis of all Indian music, whichever way you do it. Each one chooses different... In Agra, the basic thing is we do not do note by note elaboration. Like, suppose we are taking suppose we take Bihar. Sa ga ma ga re sa. Sa ga ma pa ni ga pa ma pa. The base of Bihar. Now, when we are elaborating, we don't do sa ni sa sa ni sa 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 ni sa ga ni sa ga re sa sa ga re sa ga re sa ni ga. You know, you are taking each note and doing all the various combinations. That is not the approach of, not that it is wrong. Each gharana has a different perspective. Now, we believe that a rag is formed not by just the notes, but by certain phrases which characterize or give you the picture of the rag. Sa ga ma ga. So this will be the basic. I would never start sa sa ga sa ga ma ga. I wouldn't do that. Sa ga ma ga re sa ma ga re sa sa ga ma ga pa pa. See, we are using phrases. Ga ma pa ni ga pa ni ga pa ma ga ma pa tha ga ma ga. it's a series of phrases which you join. So this is the base of our approach to a rag.
And there the imagination works person to person.
Yeah, now suppose you take a phrase. I take a bandish. Kaise samjha? This is the mukda. Samjha. Kaise samjha? Kaise? It's like painting a picture. I mean, I look at it like that. You draw one line, then you add something, then you add something else. Then you're literally building a three-dimensional sort of a picture. Three-dimensional because your taal is there, your raag is there, and your bandish gives you the words or the, what shall I say, the dhancha on which you can string these. We don't use even the bandish. Samjha. Always the words are complete. The words are not left. We won't leave it like that. Kaise, kaise, kaise. You know what I'm saying is, it's like a conversation. Khan sahab would say, जैसे तुम बात कर रहे हो किसी के पास, तो उसको कैसे समझाऊं? ये लफ्ज तुमने ले लिया, तो तुम सोचो कितनी अलग-अलग तरीके से तुम वो कह सकती हो. In imagination and how do you do it? Notes are very few.
Samjha kamagaris.
So what else do you use? You use the length of standing on each note, the way you connect the notes, the you know, you sort of give emphasis to certain note, take back, make certain notes light, add little frills, add little gamaks, means, stans. So you're giving a whole lot of intonations into that. Let me see if I can do it for you.
Samjha, 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 samjha.
See, it's almost like as if you're telling a story.
Samjha kaise kaise samjha kaise samjha samjha.
No, she's that. You know, it's as if you're telling someone, how can I make the person understand?
This conversation is happening between you and raga, or you and your own imagination?
Your imagination and the raga and the taal, everything is there. You are talking to somebody. Imagine you are talking to somebody else. You are telling them the story. That makes, you know, then you get involved. It is not that you are singing notes. It's not that you are making various combinations. That is also imagination.
Nisaga, gaga resa nisaga, gamaga samaga nisama nisaga.
That is also imagination, because you are creating different sound pictures. But what we are doing is we are adding the words to that. So we are adding a different dimension to that. Because when you are listening, for us language forms a very important means of communication. Isn't it?
Yes.
So if it's just a sound, fine, you are listening to it. If there are some words with which you can associate, with which you can make some sense, your mind also starts responding to that music in a different way. Whether that is only there if you understand the language.
Yes.
But even if you don't understand the language, samjha
kaise samjha sama jha samjha 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 sakiri kaise.
I'm sorry, my throat doesn't work.
No, so
So you know, this is what we mean by elaboration. In that there's a continuity.
Yeah.
You're not using words in isolation. There is see kaise samajhaun sakhiri
jiyara
kal nahi pare. Those are the words. I can go on elaborating kaise. It's not wrong. It's a different approach where you are giving more importance to the raga and the development rather than the punish. But in Agra, we give equal importance to all the three. So it gives a different picture.
And do you don't think that it is limiting your experiment or innovation with the raga?
You can, because we don't. You can use simple akar and do the elaborations in the middle. We can. It's not forbidden. We do that, but with the help of words, we get a lift. At least that is the way I look at it. Maybe they will think that it is inhibiting. I think it all depends on the way you have learned, the way you have been exposed to it. Some people like to use gamak, some people like to use khatkas and means. It's a personal equation with the rag and with your music. Your gharana or your school or what you have learned forms the base. But for it to be able to take shape, for it to be able to become almost a living identity when you sing, your personal taste, your personal choices, your personal likes have to come into that. Otherwise it becomes mechanical. You've practiced tans, you've practiced paltas, you've practiced even these bolalas, and you rattle them off. That is beautiful. I'm not saying it is not beautiful, because it shows the amount of practice, the amount of riyas, the amount of time, attention you have given into perfecting that. But to give it a soul, to give it life, you need something more. That's my way of looking at it. Yes. That is, as you know, my Khan Sahabur always say, har ek ko apni jagah hai. हर एक घराना हो, बंदिश हो, राग हो, हर एक चीज़, आदमी हो, हर एक को अपनी जगह है. और हमें कोई किसी को बुरा नहीं मानना चाहिए, किसी को किसी की निंदा नहीं करनी चाहिए। हर एक को अपने अपनी पसंद है, मुझे ये अच्छा लगता है, तुम्हें वो अच्छा लगता है, हर एक को रहने दो। और यू नो बट आई थिंक दैट्स अ वेरी ब्यूटिफुल वे ऑफ लुकिंग एट थिंग्स बिकॉज ईच वंस कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ वॉट इज ब्यूटिफुल चेंजेस। सो वॉट आई थिंक इज ब्यूटिफुल इन योर म्यूजिक somebody else might think that is not beautiful, but that doesn't make it not beautiful, it is still beautiful for someone else. So this principle of live and let live, I think that is the greatest gift that Khan Saab has given, to be able to accept that there are different ways of looking at things.
Yesterday she gave a lecture on Mallikarjun Munshi, totally different gharana, but her appreciation of Mallikarjun, which is highly appreciated. That's the broad-mindedness of the ustads.
Yes.
Really. Khadim Hussain Khan Saab would say, go and listen to all musicians. When he was one of a kind, I used to treat him like my father, second father. He's so broad-minded. Sabko suno. Don't go with an idea of criticizing. Go and listen. And imbibe, absorb what is good. With this kind of a broad-mindedness.
And he would come for anybody's concert if he was invited and he had that. And he would sit right in front. And he would encourage the person. He says, "Wah, bete, kya cheez ho, bahut achhe." And I remember once, I was not at all impressed by somebody singing. And here was Khan Saab sitting in front. Encouraging. And next day I said, Khan Saab, aap itne usko daad de rahe the. So he said, beta, uska jee bharna chahiye na, usko hausla dena chahiye, tab usme kya hai wo bahar aa sakta. Agar hum aise lambe muh karke baithenge, bechara wo ghabar jayega aur jo bhi hai usme wo bahar nahi aayega.
Can you imagine the broad mind?
You know, these were all little nuggets for me, which he gave me, and which I think are very, very important for me to understand what that gharana was.
You were mentioning that, you know, Khadim Hussain used to encourage disciples to listen to other gharanas.
Yes.
No, how was their exchanges between the gharanas or no?
We cannot generalize on these things. Some gharanas were very rigid, some gharanas weren't. Now, why we believe, or we can, it's very easy for us to say they were rigid. But think of those days. There was no transport,
that's what.
There was no radio. There was no internet, there was no whatever. You had to go by bailgadi or maybe the train, or and even going by train you had to have the money to go, everything. So what happened when these people sang in these, grew up in these various communities or places, their music developed its own characteristics. Now you, to go and learn from someone else, you have to go all that way, you have to go and stay there. So these characteristics of the gharanas became very synonymous with that gharana. Somewhere else they developed certain other characteristics, maybe based on one famous singer of that of their school. So then everybody wants to imitate him. So that is mainly how these characteristics might have developed. Then it's very easy for us to say they were very rigid. We don't really know. And there is a very beautiful example in Khadim Hussain Khan Saab's life itself, which he told me. Aladia Khan Saab of the Jaipur Rathroli Gharana and was in Bombay, in Babulnath. And Khadim Hussain Khan Saab and Vilayat Hussain Khan Saab were also in Bombay, in Babulnath. Would you want to continue?
What happened was, Aladia Khan Saab suddenly had to leave his house. Now, immediately, Vilayat Hussain Khan Saab, whose wife was related to Aladia Khan Saab, immediately went to Aladia Khan Saab and said, come and stay with us. So they stayed in the same house for a good 2 years. And in those times, there used to be a lot of discussion between them. And each one were discussing the aspects of each other's music. And Khadi Hussain Khan Saab says, Mujhe Allah, he used to call him Dada Allah Diya Khan Saab. He was so much older. Dada Allah Diya Khan Saab ne mujhe kafi sikhaye, cheeze sikhaye, dhamar sikhaye. And he rattled off some rags like Shuddh Kalyan, Dhanashri, Savni, you know, rags which are not very common. And thereby, between the two discussions, now many Jaipur cheezas and Agra cheezas are common. Naiki Kanada, Mero Pia Rasiya, Khambavati, Aliri Me Jaipur, you know, so many cheezas are common between these two gharanas.
And the way they sing the rags are also common to these. Maybe it is a result. Now, we cannot pinpoint and say this was taught to that gharana by this person, that was taught to, because these things don't matter. And also those people are not there for us to, and we are not trying to prove which gharana taught whom what or anything. But there was this interchange. Now in Agra gharana, what happens? Atroli Gharana was, you know, the Fayaz Khan Saab's wife belonged to the Atroli Gharana. And Vilayat Hussain's mother, Nathan Khan Saab's wife, also belonged to the Atroli Gharana. So what happened was, when they got married like this, there is a famous story you might have heard. Fayaz Khan Saab's dowry was 500 compositions. Now, what happened? When you get a dowry of 500 compositions, you learn their gaiki. So you're enriching your, and they usually married from some other gharana. So naturally that, you know, style, little bit of, not everything, little bit of that style came into your system. And also there was a rule that one learned from, not only from the father and father's side, but from the mother's brother.
Mama.
Mother's brother. From mother's brother means you are getting a wealth of information about another gharana. So then that gets added to. Now you, they were not historians. I think Indians are have not at all been good as far as history is concerned. Our history, I think it was only the British who really sort of gave us our sense of history. Otherwise, haan ye karte the, wo karte the. They never bothered about recording who taught what, who did what, nothing. It was all just continued.
Oral
tradition, and you accepted it. So we don't know who taught what.
When it comes to the performing arts, you know, most of the gharanas cutting across dances and music, you know, things are transferred to the new generation not through texts at all, not through documented history at all.
No, it is oral.
Which is always existed. Therefore, this oral tradition mainly is applicable when it comes to
vocal music. And also, you see, there are 2-3 areas we say, oh, why is someone singing like this? He has learned from someone, and that person's other student does not maybe sing. See, in an oral tradition, I listen. Suppose Khan Saab is teaching me. He doesn't write the words for me, right? He just recites the words. When I listen, I interpret what he has said in my mind according to my thought process. And I write it down. There may be a small variation in the words, in the way that it is taken. So over a period, what I teach my students undergoes a further sense of possible variation. And I have never written down except the words. There is nothing written. There is no rag patterns, there is no notation, nothing. Because Khan Saab told me, agar tum likh logi, wo kabhi bhi tumhare dimag mein baithega na. सो आई सेड क्यों खान साहब, ही सेड नहीं तुम्हारे मन में रहेगा, जब भी मुझे चाहिए हुए वो, एंड ही वुड कॉल इट छोपड़ी, वो छोपड़ी खोलूंगी और फिर उसमें है तो मुझे सीखने की जरूरत नहीं है, पाठ करने की जरूरत नहीं है, सो यू विल नॉट राइट द नोटेशन.
The same thing happened 2 years back when we were here to meet Alkesh Mehta. Hmm. He said the same word. Hmm. He also doesn't encourage people to
random meditations.
And then, I don't know whether right thing or I did the wrong thing. I believe I did the right thing. Now, I could have easily gone home and quietly written the notations. But I didn't. Because I believe that for a guru-shishya relationship, there has to be perfect trust. If there isn't perfect trust, the transfer of that tradition, there will be something lacking. Because you see, for them, their music is their whole life. And they expect complete trust of the student in them. Now, if Khan Sahib had got a slight inkling that, oh, this girl is... And they would have known. Mm. Or somewhere, if he gets some doubt, then that beautiful relation that exists, there is some flaw in it. And then that whole milieu gets vitiated. So I decided that, and he knew that my devotion to him was total. And I'm very lucky that I've got students who are like that. Because I believe it doesn't work. I could have gone home and written the notations, but he would have known, because 10 months later when he asked me to sing that, I wouldn't have known it the way he expected me to know it. For the simple reason, I would not have worked on it. But in this process, what happens? There are some things which are forgotten, some things which are lost.
How do you see that?
Some things, like now, I have learned something which I believe Khan Sahib sang like that. I don't know, I don't remember. So I make up my own little twirl. I can. Not realizing I'm making it up, but knowing the rag, knowing so many bandishes, it will be in the scheme of things.
Yeah, there is an argument in these oral traditions. You know, there are some teachers, not only in music, you know, even in literature or academics, people don't allow their students to record the classes. They say that, you know, what you listen, that is very important. You know, if you are missing certain things, it doesn't matter.
It doesn't.
The Indian history goes like that. Yes. In the oral tradition, you know, there are a lot of things were missing, but there is a beauty in what goes forward.
And also, you know, if certain things are missing, I don't think the student has the capacity to reproduce everything that the teacher did in the way that he does it, even if you record it or note it down. So what difference does it make? And our arts and music and dance and all are not so limited that if certain little small things are missing, it's going to
lapse.
You know, it's going to be that much less precious, because the next generation will add to it. Every generation has added. So maybe we've made up in some way. Yes, some rags I've forgotten. I only have the name of the rag and the bandish. And these are not sung, not performed. So now there are some rags which I look at after and nothing comes back to me. But fine. The musical world is big enough to exist without them. And I mean, that's one way of looking at it.